Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you will live also. Friends, we've gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Lauragene Kunz. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, in death resurrection. A favorite hymn of Lauragene's was Amazing Grace, and Connie's going to sing it for us.
Thank you. join me in prayer, please? Dear Heavenly Father, it is always hard to say goodbye to those who have passed away. We know that they will be missed by so many who are left behind, but Lord, you also remind us that the death of your saints is very special to you, and that we want to join together to thank you for the life of your child, Lauragene, who is such an encouragement and wonderful witness to your love and grace. Lord, thank you for the blessing of this special lady, whom we all remember so fondly, but who is now at rest in your loving embrace. Thank you for her life and the many happy memories that we share. And we pray that you will be a special comfort to uplift and care for those that will feel the greatest loss. For though we are separated for a time, we will all rejoice one day when we stand together in your presence. Thank you that the brief night of weeping will pass very quickly, and we will all be rejoicing in your presence on that glorious morning when we will all be reunited in the hope that is set before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Hear these words from 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those who have died in Christ have perished. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen. What is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going, for I am the way, the truth, and the life. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live, you also will live. I've said these things to you while I'm still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Lauragene R. Kunz, 83, passed through this world from November 21, 1935 to November 12, 2019. Surrounded by family, she passed peacefully at Edina Regional Medical Center following an extended battle with diabetes. Lauragene was born in Pickaway County, Ohio. She grew up in Yellowbud, raised her family in Londonderry, and retired in Chillicothe. She was a loving daughter to the late Oscar R. and Marguerite Maury Reynolds. On March 16, 1963, she married the late Edwin R. Kunz, whom she loved and adored. Lauragene treasured her two siblings, James Reynolds and Ruth Hutchinson. Lauragene was a loving and dedicated mother to her four daughters, Melanie, Mrs. Tim Peters of Chillicothe, Sharon, Mrs. Doug Estep of Chillicothe, Anita, Mrs. Steve Fisher of Big Clifty, Kentucky, and Venice, Mrs. David Doles of Pataskala, Ohio. She was a nurturing and endlessly patient mama to 11 grandchildren, Christy, Mrs. A.J. Bernard, Steve, Mrs. Jesse Estep, Kara, Mrs. Rory Marquardt, Benjamin, Mrs. Mahia Fisher, Laura, Mr. James Brent McReynolds, Lisa Fisher, Sarah Fisher, Joshua Hatfield, Christopher Hatfield, Nicholas Hatfield, and Clay Doles. She was also blessed with 11 great-grandchildren. She was predeceased by a daughter, Melanie Peters, and an infant grandson, Timmy Peters. Lauragene approached life with a strong passion to make others happy. She was a dedicated member of Tyler Memorial United Methodist Church and United Methodist Women's Miriam Ruth Circle. She blessed many with the gift of music, making the piano sing and singing in the church choir, cooking delicious dinners for her family, her church family, and many of the neighbor boys who helped on the farm was her true gift and passion. She blessed many people by coordinating numerous funeral dinners and banquets at the church for many years. For 83 years, Lauragene treasured the people around her. We are forever grateful to have had her unconditional love, giving heart, and fierce loyalty. While the world will surely miss her, she will continue to live through us. Her daughters, Sharon, Needy, and Nisi, are going to share with us at this time.
We would like to thank everyone for coming to honor our mother today. Your love and support has meant the world to all of us. I would like to start by saying that my mother was the strongest, bravest, and most kind-hearted woman I had ever known. Although the last few years have been plagued with illness and many challenges, this in no way defined who my mother was. My mother was vibrant, hardworking, loving, and very involved with many activities until her illness made it difficult to continue to do the things she loved. Mom always instilled in her girls the importance of the love of family and God. We were raised that family and God are everything, and she showed us that by always making sure we attended church every Sunday morning and keeping our family in constant contact with each other, even those cousins we may only see once a year. Our family reunions were many, and we always had so many relatives there in attendance. Mom was in her glory when family was around. Our family has a bond of love that can never be broken because of the efforts that Mom put in to make it that way. Family was everything to her, and she has passed that same philosophy on to us. Mom was an organizer of many things, her household being one of them. Every day had a purpose and a plan. For example, Monday was laundry day, Tuesday was ironing day, Wednesday was soup day because she had choir practice that evening and needed something quick for supper. Thursday was clean the house day. Friday was town day, which all of us loved the most. Saturday was yard work such as mowing, baking a dessert for Sunday, and preparations for Sunday dinner. Sunday was, of course, church. She always said, if you don't go to church on Sunday, don't ask to go anywhere during the week because you're not doing it. It was always better to go to church than sit at home the rest of the week. On Fridays, to avoid arguments among us as to where we wanted to eat on town day, Mom would start at one end of Bridge Street and take turns eating at every restaurant. There was no arguments because we knew that's just the way it was. When we got all the way to the end of Bridge Street, we would go down the other side and work our way back up. We always had rules that I later in life called Laurie's Laws. Mom always had things that could not be done until you were a certain age. To save time, I will explain what I mean using age 9 as a reference, because to me, this was the most important age, or so I thought. Because you were allowed to do a lot of things at this age. First of all, at age 9, you got to make your own bed. You got to burn the papers with only 4 matches. Only 4 matches, so you weren't out there playing with the matches. You could ride your bike down to Manson's store for penny candy. You got to start mowing the grass. You got to start pulling weeds out of the garden. I thought that age 9 would be great, but it didn't take me too long to realize that at age 9, you were now in the workforce. All kidding aside, it was a great childhood filled with love, compassion, and warm hugs from a great mom. One other thing before I close, my mom loved her church and the God she worshiped. She prepared many funeral dinners with her partner in crime, Joanne Tuttle, planned and executed many turkey dinners, which I always mashed the potatoes for, and cooked for many organizations outside the church. She knew that God needed to be the center of her life and taught us the same thing. I could go on for hours talking about my sweet mom, but unfortunately there just isn't enough time. I would like to say that over the last 6 months, it has been an honor and a privilege to take care of and spend time with my mom in a little different way than that of my earlier years. The closeness I had with my mother is one of the greatest gifts I will ever receive. We had so many long talks of her struggles, her wishes, her longing to join Dad, Mel, and her sister Ruth. My mom knew she was going to heaven and was so excited to be able to see again and have a new body. In closing, I would like to thank all of you here today for your cards, prayers, love, and support during such trying times as we have had. I would also like to thank Adina Hospice for their outstanding support and kindness in Mom's final hours, and the nursing staff on 2A and 2 North for loving our mother and taking such great care of her. We will be forever grateful. Also, Mom's team at dialysis, Stephanie and Shauna and Jennifer, for always loving and caring for our mother. You made dialysis so much easier for her, and she loved you all so much. Last but certainly not least, I would like to thank my sweet niece, Christy, for taking Mom to dialysis every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 5:15 a.m. for the last 7 years. She made life easier for all of us by so willingly and lovingly doing this for Mom. So I say this to you now, Mom. Thank you for being the most wonderful mother anyone could ask for. I will miss you greatly.
and I don't know who I will call in crisis. However, I'm so glad your suffering is over, and you can rejoice in heaven with your mom and dad, our wonderful father, our sister Mel, and our precious Aunt Ruth, and the grandchild you never got to hold, little Timmy. Go in peace, Mom. We love you so much.
As I sat down to write, I thought about all the wonderful things I could say about my mother. I jotted some notes down, wrote down many of her great, positive, and perfect qualities, and then I realized that words would never really be enough, and that more importantly, all of you in this room, because you already know what a wonderful woman that she was, So today, I would like to share with you some memories that I have with her. Some things that some of you may know and some of you may not. I remember as a little girl going shopping to Lazarus with my mom, and I was always afraid I would lose her because I was so attached to her, and I couldn't have been very old, I held onto her skirt so that I wouldn't lose her. My cousin Dean was different than me. He went up the escalator and we couldn't find him. I remember Mom and his mother were frantically looking for him, and here he came down the escalator with a clerk. I remember my mom stirring my hard ice cream. We always got our ice cream from the Schwann's man. She dipped my ice cream, and I didn't like it hard. Mom would stir it until it was like soft serve, just for me. I remember Mom studying my spelling words with me in the basement. I wasn't very good at spelling. And it took us hours. Niecy, she was 2 years younger than me, and she would learn to spell them before I would sometimes. But my mom never gave up on me. I remember every birthday party. We always got a birthday party with our cousins. I remember going to Children's Palace on Saturday after Thanksgiving and King's Island every May with the band. I remember Mom cooking all the food for our wedding. We had over 300 guests there. I remember Mom helping me through some of my darkest days, like when I first moved away from Ohio and when I had a miscarriage just a few years later. I remember Mom thinking I was lying when I told her we were having more than one baby again. I remember how she proudly told everybody about her daughter, who has two sets of twins, and showing off their pictures to everyone, especially at the beauty shop. I remember needing to go home to my mom for help when Lisa and Sarah were born and Ben and Laura were just two. I remember Mom and Dad coming to visit me twice a year, no matter what state or country I lived in. They always came in March and October because those were the months they didn't have a garden to tend. I remember Mom going to Lisa and Sarah's volleyball tournament. When they went to state, she couldn't see them on the floor. She couldn't tell which kids were hers. But she didn't go for herself. She went for them. And that was typical of Mom. I remember Mom just the other day making the decision to stop all medical intervention, telling every daughter, son-in-law, grandchild, and great-grandchild that she loves them and that she's proud of them. And asking Mom to pick Ben and Mariah out, a healthy baby, when she got to heaven. And on Mom's last day, I watched my mom have a conversation with someone. As far as I could see, it was just me, Christy, and Mom in the room. But clearly, we were not alone. My mom opened her eyes and said, "I remember." She continued the conversation, but none of the rest of it was understood by Christy and I. Mom told us she was not afraid to die, but she didn't want to leave her family. So it seemed like divine intervention to me that some of her last words were, "I remember." And I want all of you and her to know that I will always remember too. I love you, Mom.
I can do it. I told my mom I couldn't. She insisted. So here it goes. I have my reading glasses because I'm old and I can't see, so I can't really see you, but I can see these words. Okay. So first of all, thank every one of you. Half of us are family, and some of us are family and friends, for coming and celebrating Mom's life with us. There's a lot that I have to thank, and I want to do it first by thanking Sharon. You know, Needy and I live a little further away, and even if we didn't, Sharon stepped in right in and took Mel's place as our big sister. She was always there with Mom, even when she didn't feel like it. She took her grocery shopping when she had knee surgery and Mom wanted to push on. She took her to the hospital in the middle of the night, and Needy and I love you, and I don't know what we would do without you. And Mel was right there with us too. She gave you your energy, right? Christy, like Sharon said, I would say to Mom, "Do you really think it's fair that you ask Christy to pick you up at 5:15 a.m. every morning?" And Mom said, "Well, I want her to." And you know what? I never heard Christy complain about it. Uncle Jim, what a great brother Uncle Jim is to Mom. She always knew she could count on him, and you know, he took her to the eye doctor, he took her anywhere, the beauty shop, whatever she needed. And Uncle Jim was just amazing, especially the last years, but our whole life, as I reflect on our whole life, she really loved her siblings, for sure. Charlotte, the neighbor, I don't know what she'd do without Charlotte. In fact, she said, "Charlotte, I don't want you to go to Florida for the winter. I want you to sell that place and move back here." I'm like, "Really, Mom? Did you really say that?" She said, "I did." And Kayla and Haley, they took her to the grocery store. They truly, truly were great grandchildren and gave her a lot of love that she felt. So that's the most important message I have. But I'm not finished because I'm a person of many words. So we are truly blessed to have an amazing family, and I'm sure as she's looking at us right now, she is very pleased. After all, she planned it. Every bit of it. Her flowers, every bit of it. Lauragene, Aunt Lauragene, Laurie, Mother, Mom, by whatever name you called her, she loved us, and she was an unforgettable lady. First of all, I want to let you know, if you don't know who I am, I'm Niecy, and I am the baby. Right, Sharon?
Right.
Mom had no choice. She did. She had a choice. But she didn't have any good choice. But she made her choice. She chose to stop her medical treatment. But she could have not. She could have said, I'll keep taking my blood pressure medicine, I'll stay here for a couple more months, but she didn't. And I so respect her courage to make a decision. That was Mom, and she decided to have her passing be a beautiful event and let us be a part of it to every second. She's always strong, she's always extremely disciplined. Well, she was the oldest child. Courageous and smart. So a few days ago, Sharon and Needy and Mom and I sat on Mom's bed and planned this funeral. She planned the scripture, she planned the pastor, she planned the flowers, she planned what she was going to wear, what songs were going to be read. She planned all of it. She also planned for Sharon and me and Needy to get up here and say something. And I said, I don't think I can do it, Mom. I am an emotional wreck. I did a horrible job at Dad's. I'm not doing it. And she said, you're doing it. And I said, well, then I'm going to play trivia. And she said, absolutely not, Lucy. So we're going to play some trivia. Now, it can be interactive, but she didn't really want it that way. So maybe I'll respect her that way because I don't want her to come back. She has a little bit of power over me at this point. But here's a couple questions that we talk about. What did Mom do every day before Dad got home?
Put her lipstick on.
She swept the kitchen floor and she put her lipstick on. Her red lipstick. Just a couple more. What did Mom give out for trick or treat?
Popcorn.
Every other year. Make no mistake, she didn't give regular candy. What was she known for as a cook?
Noodles.
Yeah, her noodles. And I have one more. On what date were we allowed to go barefoot and wear our summer pajamas?
May 1st.
May 1st. No, a day before, and I just thought that was the rule. I didn't know that other people did it different. Right, David? Yeah. Okay. So, as far back as I can remember, Mom was as strong and she was unique. She was a different lady. She volunteered at the hospital, which is where she met Dad. She volunteered at school. She was the PTA president, the band parent president. She was the president of a lot of stuff. She liked to be in control for sure. She volunteered at church. She ran the kitchen. She taught Sunday school. She worked in the office. She belonged to several social groups, the guild, her church circle, the homemakers, and she was fiercely loyal, if you didn't know that already. We went to the dentist, and he heard us, and that was too bad. He was our dentist for life. We couldn't change. The same doctor, the same hairdresser. You know, we started 4-H. I didn't know that meant for 10 years, but apparently it did. She was also an extraordinarily dedicated mother. Not just to us four girls, but especially to her nieces and nephews, Dean and Lisa, and Scott and Teresa. We spent many a summers together when they stayed at our house. Without fail, she always had a hot breakfast at the table for me. She would have milk on my cereal. She would have syrup on my pancakes. And she mashed my eggs and put crackers in it. Needy wasn't the only one spoiled. I was a baby, remember? I'm the baby. She loved her grandchildren. She loved to rock her babies. And she loved to tell the story about the four of the young grandchildren killing the corn. Even though she had four daughters, she truly did all the cleaning and the cooking and the laundry. Because Dad had us outside, and she never complained about it. Okay. I remember her letting Needy and I play in her closet. And never did I realize when I was little, she had the greatest high-heeled shoes, and she had great purses and all kinds of jewelry. And until later in my life did I really realize that she truly was a beauty. She went to the hairdresser every Friday, smelled good with powder, dressed her best every day, and she always greeted Dad with her freshly painted lips. As I've grown up, Mom continued to inspire me and be my best. Her integrity and her actions gave me the strength and the confidence to start my life, my career, and my family. I'm almost done. One of my first memories of Mom was the special one-on-one time she gave me every day. Even though she frequently told me that I talked too much, too loud, and too fast, she always listened and let me share my feelings and ideas and stories. Up until the day she died, my time slot was 5:10 to 5:45 p.m. She talked me all the way through my fears, and she let me share my happy times. She just let me be me and unwind. We had a lot of laughs, maybe a lot of tears in the early days, honestly. But every day she talked me from work to home, and I'm gonna miss it. I don't know who I'm gonna call. David? Mom planned everything down to her last breath, no doubt about it. She didn't want to leave her family, but she felt the fight and was ready to go to heaven. Mom battled fiercely, especially her last couple of years. And like Sharon said, I hope you remember her as the beautiful, strong, and unique, and inspiring lady that she was. Love and peace. Thank you.
Thank you. Those of us who knew Lauragene knew her as quite a cook. As I give some of my memories, she kept track of the meals she fixed so she would know what menu she last had for that event. As she and Ed would have my family for a meal every year, she also knew what each of us liked. As a dedicated church worker, I knew her as an accompanist for the children's choir, administrative council recording secretary who took minutes in shorthand, as pastor parish relations chairperson, as Sunday school superintendent, a member of the choir, the kitchen committee, president of the Miriam Ruth Circle, and head of the church's consolation meals, to name a few. My kids remember her homemade noodles and hosting with Ed the all-church picnic at their farm. Pam and I were very much appreciated her and Ed's support in making a bedroom for our daughter in the parsonage basement. They bought the carpet, and Doug and other family members did the work. I was always impressed with Lauragene's memory and her organization. She did certain things on particular days, as was mentioned, such as her laundry, cleaning, and the like, and she kept records well. Most of us, of all, was the love she had and showed others, particularly her family. Kara was Beth's college roommate for 4 years. She called me when Steve's youngest was born, and so small he could put his wedding ring up to her thigh. She informed me when Ben's daughter was in the University of Kentucky Medical Center, and I was glad I was able to visit them and pray. And now it's my privilege to be part of her going home celebration. For Lauragene loved not only her church, her family, but her Lord. We are blessed to have known Lauragene Kunz and her having touched our lives. When I last spoke to Lauragene, I asked her what her favorite scripture was, and she said John 3:16. It states, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And verse 17 continues, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." The next question I asked Lauragene was if she knew Jesus as her Savior, and she said yes. It's no wonder that this was her favorite scripture verse. John 3:16 has been referred to as the golden text of the Bible, for it contains the gospel in a nutshell. God loves us. He loves us so much, He gave. He gave the best He had to offer, His only Son. He gave what cost Him dearly, not a cheap gift, but a sacrificial gift. God created us in love and for fellowship with Him. He made us for a relationship with Him. And until we have a personal relationship with God in knowing Him, we are incomplete, lacking, and longing for only what God can fulfill in us. And Jesus came to establish that relationship. We've been separated from our Creator and the homeland of our souls because of sin. Because of sin, we've been surrounded by troubled waters, alienated from God's complete, perfect will and His beautiful presence. Our sins separate us from our holy God, who loves us and wants a relationship with us. So the sinless Son of God, Jesus, came to be the payment for our sins. He took the penalty of death for our sins. He shed His blood for remission, forgiveness of our sins. That whoever believes in Him, that means you and me, will not perish, but have everlasting life. As God has taken the initiative and provided the bridge to Him, ours is to accept by faith His provision for our sins, which is Jesus' death and resurrection. Jesus bridges the gap between sinful persons and a holy God. He is the remedy to establish the relationship with God for which we were created and long for. So how do we cross that bridge that leads to eternal life? Firstly, we repent. We must first recognize our sinfulness and must turn from it towards God. Secondly, believe. Believe in Jesus Christ. Believe He died for your sins and rose again for your personal relation and salvation. And thirdly, receive. By faith, receive forgiveness for your sins. By faith, receive Jesus at what He's done for you on the cross and in His resurrection. By faith, receive the eternal life He offers to you in Himself. And so by faith receive Jesus, God's Son, sent in love, so that we might not perish, but have everlasting life. For you see, God sent not His Son into the world to condemn us, but to save us. In our sins we are condemned already, but in Christ Jesus we are saved. The wages of sin is death, meaning separation from God. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, His Son. That's good news. We can have life with God. Ours is to ask for it. No wonder this is the golden text of the Bible. God loves us and has provided the way for us to be eternally with Him, where there is no sickness or death, hunger or pain, sorrow or bloodshed, but peace, joy, and life. In Jesus is the victory over sin and death, and we shall receive a crown of victory as we live faithfully here for Him. That will be a glad day. Where is she now? We are in sorrow. She is in total joy. We see the separation. She's in the presence of the Lord. We know weeping. She has had all the tears wiped away. We share a deep loss. She has gained a crown that will not fade away. We are aware of her absence. She has been welcomed home. A favorite hymn of Lauragene's was "In the Garden" that Connie Center is going to sing.
Still.
Pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways we trust you, and to you with your church on earth and in heaven we offer honor and glory now and forever. O God, all that you've given us is yours. As first you gave Lauragene to us, now we give her back to you. Receive her into the arms of your mercy and raise her up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. God of love, we thank you for all with which you've blessed us. Even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends and for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death, and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us as we pray in his name. Amen. Amen. Lauragene loved singing, and she'd like for us all to stand and sing 156, I Love to Tell the Story.
Jesus.
peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated and you'll be ushered.
Thank you. That's pretty true.